Norway Fights On. This is Gladys Pitt, bringing you another in the series Norway Fights On. And my guest today is Mr. Hartvig Kiran, assistant editor of the Norwegian State Broadcasting in London, England, who is in this country on a short visit. He will tell us about the important contact which, through the Norwegian broadcasts in London, has been established between the people in conquered Norway and their countrymen who are still fighting on the outside. It is a pleasure to introduce to you now Mr. Hartvig Kiran.
The first thing to be lost in a war is truth. This sentence was created by the experiences of the last war, but it has a much more profound meaning in this one, where our enemies from the outset have used lies as a main weapon in their warfare. As a broadcaster in London, it has been my duty to inform my countrymen in Norway of the truth. It has been a tough job, because up to now, the truth has been anything but pleasant. From personal meetings with persons who escaped from Norway, I know that the contact between us is of a very close and intimate nature. They rely upon us, and my trip to the United States was made in order to tell my compatriots from first-hand experience what is really going on over here. There is no doubt that America has become a deciding factor in this war, and I'm glad to state that what I've seen here so far will be very encouraging to my listeners in Norway. As a member of an old seafaring nation, which I dare say today plays an important part in the vital battle of the oceans, I especially look forward to seeing some of your shipbuilding yards. I came to one plant on the East Coast, and what I witnessed there impressed me indeed. In the course of little more than 1 year, this yard has grown from practically nothing to be the largest shipbuilding plant on the eastern coast of America. Last month, it broke the All-American record by launching 12 large merchant ships, which, placed stem by stern, would cover a whole mile, another mile added to our vital bridge of ships. Of course, every American knows that the peoples of Europe felt greatly encouraged when America entered the war. To them, it has become more and more evident that every nation fighting the Axis is fighting not only for herself, but for every other country where the ideals of freedom, tolerance, and human decency mean anything to the nation as a whole. We were all late in realizing it, and we know the consequences. Yet the fact that we have been able to carry on in spite of an almost unbroken series of defeats and disasters proves that we have a moral strength which is bound to bring its rewards, provided we are willing to make the sacrifices necessary. No sacrifice we can make will be greater than those made by the defenseless peoples of Europe. In the reports from Norway, which we receive regularly through our broadcasting work in London, we have, for instance, never once heard of anyone complaining about the scarcity of food, although it is an established fact that the public health has already been gravely affected by it. Children, in particular, will have to bear the marks of it for the rest of their lives. Thousands have been and are still being imprisoned. Additional thousands are being forced to build fortifications, not for themselves, but for the enemy. Not to mention the countless executions. Still, they stand firm. I suppose you have all heard about the resistance being offered in Nazi-occupied Norway. There is much more which could be told, were it not for the consideration which has to be taken in order not to expose our people to further dangers. One must always bear in mind that among our keenest listeners are our enemies. It may surprise some of you to learn that our broadcasts from London do not deal exclusively with news from the outside world. Indeed, a main part of our work consists of telling our listeners what is going on within their own borders. in order to suppress all efforts towards a united opposition. The Germans have done their utmost to keep the people in ignorance of what is happening, not only outside Norway, but also outside their own small communities. This wouldn't seem difficult in view of the fact that they control all communication and transportation in the country. The most important contribution made by London was, therefore, that it established a contact between all soldiers on the home front, as we call it, and between the home front and the front abroad. When the time for the London broadcast was near, the waiters in the restaurants had a busy time making out the checks for all the guests who wanted to quit. For a short time, the streets were buzzing with people hurrying home, until they were quite empty, and you could suddenly hear a voice through the open windows, "This is London calling." I remember one evening when I was still in Norway and it was still allowed to have radio sets. I was on my way to an appointment just at the time when the news from London was being read. Through the walls and the open windows of every house on my way, I was able to hear every word of the news bulletin. It was even considered indecent to call on people or even to telephone them while the London news was on the air. The statistics of a telephone company in one Norwegian town showed that shortly before the news, the curve indicating telephone conversations suddenly dropped down to zero, to rise suddenly again as soon as the news was finished. Even small children were acutely aware what London meant to everybody. One evening, after I had resigned from my job at the broadcasting in Oslo and was staying in my hometown, the daughter of my brother, 6 or 7 years old, sat down beside me and said, "Say, uncle, weren't you a broadcaster in Oslo?" "Yes, I was," I replied. "And those who speak from London now, they were also broadcasters in Oslo, weren't they?" "Yes, they were," I said. Then she looked at me in great surprise and said, "But, uncle, why aren't you in London then?" Later on, when I was in London, I was told by friends who came abroad that she never got tired of telling people when I came on the air that this was her uncle speaking. Today, however, she is probably not able to listen to me, because now it is a job for very grown-up people to listen into London. In connection with the execution of the first victims of Nazi terror in Norway in September last year, the Germans ordered every radio set which did not belong to Nazis to be given up to the German military authorities. Every person, the decree said, who after a certain date was found in possession of a radio set was liable to sentences of hard labor or even death. The threat of death clearly indicates the tremendous importance which the German authorities attached to our broadcasts. But our countrymen were not terrified. You can certainly no more walk through a Norwegian street and hear the voice of London calling through the open windows. But if you were able to find a person who would rely upon you, you might be led to the strangest hidden places where patriots are tuning into our station at the risk of their lives. The willingness of people in the occupied countries to sacrifice anything for the common cause will prove to be of inestimable value when the Allied invasion is going to take place. We ought to be grateful for it, but they are much more grateful than we are. At a meeting in London, I was together with a friend of mine who also speaks regularly on the London radio. After the meeting, some people who had been brought to England after a raid on the Norwegian coast came over to us. There was no mistaking their sincerity when they expressed their gratitude for all we had done for them, as they said. When two young men from my hometown who had been sentenced to death were visited by some friends who wanted to see them for the last time, one of them said, I shall never forget his words, "Tell all our friends not to worry about us. We have been prepared for this for a long time, and we are not afraid. We on the home front are today the front-line soldiers in this war, and we shall have to keep that position until our friends are prepared to relieve us. In every fight, the soldiers of the first line must be prepared to die. So don't worry about us." But we must worry about them. We cannot expect the Nazis to be crushed by an uprising of the subjugated people. Even the heart of a lion is of no avail against machine guns. No courage can prevail against tanks and planes. They can certainly do a lot, but only when we are prepared to step in. Therefore, we should remember that every tank, plane, or ship in excess of plans may mean one day nearer to victory. Every day gained for the peace may mean thousands of lives saved for the future. The happiness of millions depends upon us.
Thank you so much, Mr. Kiran. You have heard another in the series, Norway Fights On. Today, my guest was Mr. Hartvig Kiran, assistant editor of the Norwegian State Broadcasting in London, England. And so, until next week, when we have another interesting program for you, this is Gladys Petch saying adieu. Gladys Petch, bringing you another in the series, Norway Fights On. Our guest today is Lieutenant Colonel Raystart, Chief of the Royal Norwegian Air Forces in Canada, where the Norwegian government has set up a modern training camp for aviators. Lieutenant Colonel Raystart was squadron leader when the war broke out in Norway, and he fought during the 62 days of fighting there, having the command of the Norwegian Army Air Force during those last dreadful weeks. It is indeed a privilege to introduce to you now Lieutenant Colonel Raystart. And I want to ask you first, I understand you've been in England recently, Colonel Raystart, and have seen the Norwegian pilots in action overseas. Can you tell us something of what they are doing?
I wish you could see the reports we get from the places where the Norwegian flyers are in action. Our naval flyers in Iceland are on regular convoy and sub-tracing duty. Our flying boats have been visiting the Norwegian coast for a long while now, and our Spitfires are in daily battle over France, Holland, and Belgium. Two English experts told me that our Norwegian boys are excellent flyers and first-class fighters who do not have to take second place for anyone now, and they will be better. When I was in England, I saw our Norwegian flyers in first line of battle. Serious, hard-working lads who are already veterans of over a year of fighting. And more of them are on the way. Just now, while we are waiting for bombers, most of our bomber pilots are busy in the ferry service. While I was waiting at the airfield in England a few weeks ago, I saw two huge bombers arrive from America. The crews of both ships were boys from Little Norway, who are now taking the trip across the Atlantic as a matter of course. Not long ago, Sir Frederick Bowhill, the chief of the ferry command, was in Little Norway, and he praised the work of our radio, telegraphists, navigators, and flyers very highly. Our men in the ferry command are learning to handle even the big four-engine bombers, and as soon as Norwegian bomber units are a reality, they will get a flying personnel which knows the job inside and out, and I will see that we pay back our debts to the Germans in proper fashion. No, you can't be sure we are not unprepared the way we were in April 1940. Now we met the Nazis on an even footing. When the Spitfires meet the German planes in the air and projectiles from Norwegian cannons and machine guns rip into them, the youth of Norway is on the wings, ready to pay back all the sufferings they have brought over our country.
Are you surprised at these results, Colonel?
No, when you think of what these young lads have gone through now. They grew up in a peaceful, contented land where people were used to getting ahead by honest, honorable work. They looked down with the greatest contempt on all these honorable shortcuts to fortune would bring ruin or slavery or extermination to others, whether individuals or group or whole peoples are concerned. The entire Norwegian people hold such shortcuts in scorn and contempt. Yes, you can safely say the entire Norwegian people, for you cannot pay any attention to the trash you find in every country and which are not as much as 1% of the Norwegian people, weak and normal individuals, opportunists and profiteers, and a drunken good-for-nothings and downright criminals who are our Nazi party today. This cocktail, shaken well together and directed by the Gestapo efficient sadists, was supposed to run our country after the Germans have attacked our peace-loving people in the most contemptible manner, in spite of their most binding and solemn guarantee that they would not. It is clear that our fine youth couldn't stand by and let this rebel be there, after they have fought a stubborn but hopeless fight against the German war machine which has poured in over Norway. It is so far from our Norwegian mentality to let law and justice be replaced by brute force that our youth took matters into their own hands. Nearly every one of the young men who came here has his own story of underground work that went on, no matter how fearful the punishment. His story of and despair and hate of those who were without weapons and a growing desire to fight with real weapons, how these scenes have burned into their souls when no risk or danger could stop them any longer. The day of departure came. It is the same, whether it was a broken-hearted mother who could not hold her tears back, or a proud father, or a little crowd of admiring brothers and sisters who saw Frederick, or Sigurd, or Olaf, or Ola, leave for the other side of the earth, for Toronto, where a radio said the Norwegian Air Force was being built up and where the use of Norway was needed to fight back. Perhaps the happiest of all were those who said goodbye only to a loved one's grave before they set out on one of the most adventurous journeys young men have ever undertaken. The Gestapo's fearful punishment could not stop them. They disappeared in every direction. In their wake lay names of places like Moscow, Siberia, Japan, Odessa, Istanbul, Iraq, Baghdad, Bombay, Chongqing, Himalaya, Hong Kong, Manila, Durban, Cape Town, Trinidad, Bermuda, Panama, San Pedro. These names give an idea of what they have been through since a wild mountain peak or a green hilltop on the border gave them last farewell from the homeland. Yes, and we must not forget the modern Vikings whose courage puts to shame anything their forefathers did in the olden times. They set their course in the west in rich little boats, in the winter storms, across the North Sea or Arctic Ocean to England, Scotland, Shetland, the Orkneys, Iceland, Spitsbergen, Greenland, Chiang Mai, and Newfoundland. Leif Erikson, in his great Viking ship, was an amateur in comparison with these boys who set out in the winter night in frail little vessels that did not merely have the element to face either. Planes, U-boats, and mines took their harvest. Even if the last thing they saw was a snow-decked, poor stripe of coastline with harsh, threatening mountains, which disappeared into the winter night, still there is no sight that will warm their hearts more than a sight of that coastline rising from the sea again. Or will a mist in their eyes keep them from seeing it at all? And so, after countless adventures, after months of hardship, they came at last to Camp Little Norway in Toronto. Their spirit rose again when I saw the bright Norwegian flag flying from a high, solid flagpole in real Norwegian fashion. From buildings to buildings, they went to see if things were really like what they had heard. Their worn rags disappeared, and they put on their battle dress and got their number as soldiers. Perhaps the telegraph has already brought word of new things in Norway. Someone's father or brother has felt the Nazis' reprisal, and the whole camp is touched by it. Finally, the finishing flyer go overseas to form new Norwegian squadrons or to take the place of those who have fallen. New farewells, but no bitter sorrow now, even if one is going into danger, perhaps to death, for now the journey is in the right direction, towards home. That is why I am not surprised at our flyers' result in the battle. For us Norwegians, it is the most natural thing in the world. Take one illustration. One day I came to one of our fighter squadrons, which are in first line in South England. I wasn't a welcome guest because a rumor had spread that I needed a couple of instructors with battle experience back in Canada. Everyone seemed to say, "What are you doing here? Go back home and don't bother us. We are busy settling up affairs with the Germans and we won't go back to Canada for any price." All this in spite of the fact that the Germans had somewhat better war material and were taking their toll among our people, even if we naturally paid them back for it. One day some Norwegian boys shot down no less than three of these much feared Focke-Wulf 190, the world's best parachute plane.
How is recruiting going on now, Colonel? Do they still get out of Norway? Don't the Germans take reprisals now against whole villages, as well as individual relatives and friends, when anyone manages to escape?
There are very few who escape now. The watch is much sharper than it used to be, and the punishment is more barbaric and extensive than ever before. But the real reason that so few get out is lack of means of transportation and the fact that they cannot get through the German front in Finland and Russia. And besides, the Air Force is especially unlucky because most of the newcomers are needed for our Army and Navy.
Does that mean then you are going to stop the training of new flyers in Canada entirely?
No, we haven't thought of stopping yet. But now I hope there are some Norwegian girls over here who can give us a hand in a pinch. You see, there are some women can handle as well as a man. Not only such things as cooking, cleaning up, office work, driving cars and the like. I'd like to try them out on a little special mechanic work. And washing and polishing planes, care of parachutes and such things. So we can free as many of the boys as possible for fighting service overseas. In fact, I have thought of starting a recruit school for girls only just as soon as enough volunteers. If there are any girls between 18 and 30 listening to this program who speak or understand Norwegian and are willing to take any sort of a job in the camp, I hope they will write at once to Royal Norwegian Air Force, Little Norway, Toronto, Canada. Regulations and application blanks will be sent them at once.
I'm sure you're going to get an awful lot listening to you, who will answer you, but isn't it taking quite a chance to admit such a large female element into your work?
Oh, yes. I am well aware that we will have a great many new problems to deal with in the camp when a woman comes. but I don't see why we can't handle those problems all right. However, I will warn every romance-hungry young lady from trying her luck with us. Our people have asked us to go out and fight with everything we have to free our country from the stranglehold the gangster nations have on our country today. Our work is deadly serious and will be until Norway is free again.
Thank you, Lieutenant Colonel Raystart, for a most wonderful talk and for giving us your precious time to come here today. You have heard another in the series, Norway Fights On. And the guest speaker today was Lieutenant Colonel Raystart, Chief of the Royal Norwegian Air Force. And so, until next week, when we shall have another program for you, this is Gladys Petch saying adieu. Norwegian Information Service presents another transcribed program in the series Norway Fights On.
One year ago, high in the darkened skies over Nazi Europe, a huge four-motored bomber thundered toward Wuppertal in the Rhineland, its bomb bay loaded with high-powered destruction. Underneath the bulky flying suits of the crew, hearts are beating fast, nerves are keyed up, eyes peer intently through the night, palms are sweating, and hands are just the least bit shaky. For tonight, seven men are on their first operational trip.
George? Hello, George? Pilot to navigator, George?
Navigator here? Sorry, old boy, I was busy with these squiffy charts.
Where are we, George? Are we nearly there?
I say, that's the third time you've asked that. You're as impatient as an expectant father, Jürgen.
Are we nearly there?
I've just been checking. We're between Dusseldorf and Cologne. About 20 minutes.
Good. I have been waiting a long time for this. Jan? Jan, you heard that? The waiting is over. Now we are ready to work. Bob, just see that you don't miss with those bombs.
Don't worry. Dead-eye Bob, they're going to call me after tonight.
Good, Bob.
Why is the pilot so anxious to kill? Who is he that it's so important to him? What manner of man is this killer who sits at the controls, willing his ship to go faster?
I am not a killer, but I am going to kill tonight. And I am glad. I have come halfway around the world for this chance to hit back at the Nazis. But I am not a killer at heart. I am just an ordinary human being, just like you. Once I had a home, family and friends and a way of life. Now they are gone. Who am I? I am sorry, you do not know me. I am a Norwegian. My name? Suppose you just call me Jürgen. That is not my real name, but it will do. The lad sitting beside me is another Norwegian. Jan is his name. The others in my crew are English, Welsh, Canadian. We are all alike tonight. We are out to kill. Yet perhaps we are not all the same. For they can't seem quite to understand Jan and me. Oh, they are fighters too, but they are fighting for something they might lose. Jan and I are fighting for something we have lost, that we may never see again unless... Does that explain this eager desire to kill? I like the things you like. Fishing, music, my job, flying. But the Germans destroyed these things. They destroyed everything we were taught to respect. Honor, honesty, sportsmanship, love, decency, loyalty. We were brought up to respect these things. When I was about 10 years old, my father had promised to take me fishing for the first time.
Father, we're really going fishing this Sunday, aren't we?
Yes, son.
Well, here, Father, I made something for us.
Upon my soul, you've tied some trout flies. Uh-huh. Well, they're fine, son, but Where did you get the hooks?
Oh, is there anything wrong with them?
Son, we don't use hooks with barbs on them.
Why not, Father?
If we were fishing for food, yes. But we're going to fish for sport. If you're going to be a sportsman, you don't want all the advantages. Well,
how do you mean, Father?
Well, man is smarter than the fish. Stronger, has better tools to catch the fish, and a lure to trap the fish. Don't you think a real sportsman would be content to fish without the added advantage of barbed hook?
I suppose so, Father.
Of course you do. One must always be a sportsman, son. Not only with fish, but with your fellow human beings. Be fair, be honest, and try hard. You'll always have the love and friendship and respect of all the people who know you.
Well, is that important?
Yes, it is, son. It's one of the most important things in life.
Oh, then we won't use these flies I tied, huh?
Of course we will. We'll file the barbs off, and you'll learn to be a real fisherman.
That doesn't breed cold-blooded killers.
Navigator to skipper. About 10 minutes to target, skipper.
Good, George. Everything looks pretty clear. No flag at all. Too clear. I almost wish they would send some night fighters up.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
You see, my crew feels it too. And yet it is strange for me to think that way. It is not natural. Father would never approve, not even now, I don't suppose. Think of others. Yes, that is what he always said. He taught me its meaning, too. One day in my last year of high school, Father called me in. Hello, Father. You wanted to see me?
Yes, son. Sit down.
Yes, Father.
Your grades have been none too good these last few terms. Yet I know you can get good marks. Excellent marks. You could win that Johnson Scholarship or the Olive Berg Award in your last year in high school.
You mean that unless I do win one of them, I can't go to the university?
No, not that, son. But you have brothers and sisters. Maybe they might like to go to university. If you won a scholarship...
You mean...
It would make it easier for me to ensure they're going to university. You don't want to start work right after high school, do you?
No, sir.
No, neither do your brothers and sisters.
I know now that was another lesson in living. A lesson in the happiness you get from thinking of others. I studied hard and won a scholarship. My father was very pleased. Those were happy times that followed. The days at the university came and went so quickly. And at graduation, I was so proud. An engineering degree and a pilot's license in the Air Force Reserve. I didn't learn to fly for war, just for fun. It was fun, too, working in the laboratory in a big factory. Life was very pleasant. Then, one day...
Have you heard the news, Jürgen? The Germans have landed.
No. Are you sure?
Yes, it's true, all right. Came over the Oslo stations, official. They're broadcasting every few minutes.
German battleships have smashed the secondary system of fortifications guarding the approaches to Oslo and are now proceeding to engage the remaining line of forts. Military authorities also admit the capture of the airport by paratroops, and German transport planes can be seen shuttling back and forth. This may be the last time we are on the air, but keep tuned to this station for developments.
Our country was at war. Fight me? Well, I suppose I should. I was not a fighting man, but if our country is being invaded, every man must help defend his country.
Oslo calling. Oslo calling. Let me state that the earlier news reports were unfounded and false. There has been no invasion. It is true that the German troops have landed on Norwegian territory, but it is for our protection against our enemies. Even now, a strong force of the British is on its way here to wage war on Germany through Norway. This is a flagrant breach of our treaty with the English. But we need have no fears. The Germans will protect us. We now ask those who mistakenly fled the city to return. The normal functions of the city have been resumed. And for those not engaged in vital work, today is officially declared a holiday.
That change of attitude was the giveaway. Oslo was in German hands. The radio station was under German control. I guess that was when I first really thought of joining my squadron and fighting to defend my country. But then when I tried to get to the field, it was deserted. Planes and personnel evacuated to a jump ahead of the Germans. I finally found them in the hills. Then came Narvik and the real fighting. We beat the Huns back, and we might even have retaken northern Norway, but that was not to be. The British troops were retiring to bolster their units in France. And for us was a choice. To England, or lay down our arms and stay in Norway. Perhaps if I went back to my job, perhaps I could even help my country if I stayed. Passive resistance, perhaps. I guess I must have been stubborn, for my upbringing made me not want to fight and kill. I stayed. And I am glad I did stay. For it was during this time I learned why I should become a killer. I went back to my old work. And for a time, things were fairly peaceful. But soon, bit by bit, the hand of the Gestapo started tightening around our throats. One night, my friend Chris and I were idling over coffee when out of the loudspeaker...
Achtung! Achtung! By order of the Gauleiter for District Number 6, it is decreed that all Norwegians must be in their homes by 8 o'clock at night. Anyone found loitering in the street will be brought to police headquarters for questioning. Those found without satisfactory explanation will be shot.
It is getting worse, Chris.
Yes, it's just an excuse to shoot us.
Even then, I was still on peaceful terms. But little by little, my attitude was changed. Then Chris came in one morning and said,
Jürgen, have you heard?
Heard what, Chris?
They arrested Einar last night.
Einar? Who works at the desk beside me?
Yes, they're making an example of him. They're going to shoot him.
No.
Where? This morning, in the square. Come on. There. See?
Poor Einar.
Why must they do this to him?
Quiet!
The time has come for us to strike back.
Yes, Jürgen.
They have made killers of us, Chris. I want to kill. Someday we will give you Nazis a rich harvest of fire and steel. Sometimes when this hot lust to kill makes me doubt I am a human being, I just remember. Remember that so long as the Nazi lives on the face of this earth, I will try to kill him.
Navigator to pilot. This is it, Skipper. Dead ahead.
Good boy, George.
Target sighted, Skipper.
Good.
Ready to take over, Bob?
All set.
Take over then and don't miss.
I won't, Skipper.
Hold her steady. Steady. Bomb doors open.
Bomb doors open.
Steady. Left, left. Steady. Right away. Steady. Bomb's gone.
Mr. Hitler. You want to know the names of my family. They are written on these bombs we have just dropped. Presents from all of us. The harvest of fire and steel we promised. But you'll never read the names, never. Because when they hit, they will explode. And they'll smash your war factories, Mr. Hitler. They'll kill your workers. Look up, Mr. Hitler. Look up. Death from me and my family. Death from all of us who love liberty and freedom. Death to you from all of us who will not be beaten. Mr. Hitler, you're tasting my first blow for freedom.
Bombs exploded. Photo flash gone. A direct hit, Skipper. A direct hit.
At last, I have struck back.
The story you have just heard is founded on actual fact. You have heard another program in the series Norway Fights On. presented by the Royal Norwegian Information Service, an agency of the Royal Norwegian Government. And so, until our next visit with you, goodbye, everybody. Fights on with the spirit of the Vikings. Christmas in Norway. Christmas and winter snow covering the country. This Christmas, as before, the church bells will ring in the Yuletide. The distant chimes from a chapel on the hillside, from a small weather-beaten church high up on a wind-swept mountain, will echo over the quiet valley and hamlets sleeping beneath the snow, across the endless snowfields, the dark forests, over the mountains and fjords. The deep notes of the bells will call the city folk to church on Christmas Eve, as they have done for hundreds of years. Generation after generation have assembled around the Christmas tree to rejoice in the Christmas message of the Savior's birth. Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Silent night, holy night, peace on earth. The words seem almost a blasphemous mockery in war-torn Norway, in a land stripped bare of everything that makes for Christmas joy and gladness. A land where all the Christmas teachings about justice and freedom have been trodden under the iron heel of the conqueror. But the Christmas festival will bring the people together and bind their hearts to one another. It will give them strength and faith to hold out until they can once more say, peace on earth in a free Norway. And great and small will gather around the Christmas tree in all of Norway's thousand homes. They will take one another's hands and sing once more the ancient carols of the Christmas season. Let us rejoice this Christmas Eve, for Christ the Lord is born. That is the Norwegian children's favorite carol, and they will rejoice when they sing it, this year as ever. For the little ones have childhood's wonderful ability to forget all that is hard and cruel, the war and want and suffering, the oppression and hatred. There won't be many Christmas presents for them this year. Under the new order, the packages have disappeared from under the Christmas tree. But the tree itself, the Christmas tree in all its glory, will be there, with its glittering ornaments and flags and lighted candles. And the Christmas tree will bring with it all the joy of Christmas into the home. Churches will be filled this Christmas, filled more than ever before. The church has been Norway's mightiest fortress, invincible in her fight against the oppressors, proud and valiant and unyielding. She will proclaim the Christmas gospel of joy and consolation, and the congregation will greet the glad tidings of the Savior's birth with the familiar hymn. beautiful savior. The ancient crusader's hymn has always been one of the most beloved Christmas hymns in Norway. Crusaders, that is what the Norwegians are today. Clergy, teachers, workers, farmers, fishermen, rich and poor, high and low. Soldiers dedicated to a holy, a free Norway, where the teachings of Christ can once more rule the hearts of men, and they know they are not fighting alone. The unknown fighters on the Norwegian home front, the seamen on the seven seas, the Norwegian airmen, and the men in Norway's army and navy know that they fight with the feeling of brotherhood with all the United Nations, for right and justice, for the four freedoms, for all that makes life worthwhile. They fight with the courage and spirit of the Vikings of old, but for a far more holy cause, for a world in which men once more can say on Christmas Day, peace on earth, goodwill to all men.
Norwegian Information Service. The narrator was Gladys Petsch. The music under direction of Agnes Purdy.
The Royal Norwegian Information Service presents another transcribed program in the series Norway Fights On. My guest today is Mr. Carl Soiland, well-known Norwegian-American editor of the most influential newspaper, Norwegian newspaper, in this country. Mr. Soiland is a leader of the cultural life amongst Norwegian-Americans in Brooklyn and is an author and a musician. He is also the founder of the Intime Forum Group, which is a lecture and debating society immensely popular with Norwegian-Americans. It is indeed a privilege to present to you now Mr. Carl Soiland.
During the current war, America has been visited by many Europeans. Among them are writers and journalists whose work has had a double purpose: to tell their people back in the occupied countries about America through radio and other channels, and also to serve as channels for the distribution of news. Quite a number of Norwegian visitors, well-known writers and journalists, with keen powers of observation and a background of wide social scope. What do these people think? How do they feel about America? The leading Norwegian-American newspaper, Nordisk Tidende, published in Brooklyn, has just completed a survey which will give a clue to the answer. We send out questionnaires to a number of refugees. We asked four questions, urging them to answer honestly and straightforwardly. They were given the choice of replying anonymously or over their signature. About half of them preferred to sign their names. The four questions were as follows. 1. What do you like least of all in America? 2. What do you like best in America? 3. What, as a Norwegian, have you missed most during your stay here? 4. Is there anything particularly, say, of the American way of life, which you would like to take back with you to Norway, with a view of transplanting it in Norway? The answers make interesting material. Answering the first question, what they do not like in America, the visitors mention certain aspects of the political system, also the deficiencies in various aspects of social security. Some mention the manifestation of race hatred, which they have noticed or read about in the newspapers, the unsettled Negro problem. Some dislike the noise and restlessness of the big cities and certain aspects of American advertising. Some have noticed a tendency to religious hypocrisy, an easy superficial optimism, and the same kind of pessimism. One may say that these are a great lot of dislikes. On the other hand, the dislikes are greatly outweighed by what these visitors like in America. One mentions that he has been most impressed by the great possibilities in this country, the unlimited scope for scientific and technical research. He points to the fact that a good portion of the best brains in the world is now at work in America. Many of the persons who answer are impressed by the tremendous material advancement in industry and transport, and in all the little things which make life more comfortable and convenient. They mention all the new ideas in use in the educational system of America, the efforts expended in adult education through evening schools, university extension courses, through radio, films, and concerts. As for American literature, most of them have read, in translations home in Norway, Hemingway, Sherwood Anderson, Dreiser, Wolfe, Sinclair Lewis, Upton Sinclair, Dos Passos, etc. Our visitors certainly like the modern American literature, and they are especially impressed by the free expression of opinion and criticism employed by the younger writers. Some journalists mention, I like the best of the American newspapers, American journalism and reporting, as exemplified in the great papers like the New York Times and the Herald Tribune, I also like PM, Life, Time, The Nation. On the whole, these Norwegian visitors like the American people. One writer expresses this this way.
The American we meet in America is quite different from the one met traveling in Europe. At home, the American is easygoing and straightforward, untrammeled by traditions, industrious. He is a kind, friendly person with a brilliant sense of humor. I also like a country where nobody asks, "Who are your parents?" Especially if one happens to have been unlucky in the choice of parents.
One writes,
"What I like most is the quiet America as you find it in the small towns in New England, where people have been settled for generations, inheriting from the early settlers friendliness, helpfulness, respect for others, a life close to the beauty of nature."
And another writes,
"I like the American spirit as expressed in the following saying, 'Whatever is difficult, we will do today. What is impossible, we will do tomorrow.' The will to take a chance, a risk, seems to be much greater here than in the old countries. The total result of this spirit has been progress, resourcefulness, and self-confidence. This American spirit has saved America and the rest of the world from 1,000 years of humiliation and misery."
Still another writes,
"I like the great wonderful idea which is America, as it has been expressed in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, as it is lived by the great majority of the American people, as it has been interpreted in song, as, for instance, by Paul Robeson singing the Ballad of Americans."
The third question, "What, as a Norwegian, have you missed most over here?" brought rather short answers and might be expressed in one word, Norway. Norway, with its mountains, fjords, forest, and rugged coastline, summer, winter, spring, and autumn, the easy access to nature from every city, town, and village, the outdoor life, skiing, sailing, hunting, fishing, hiking. Some is, quote, "the fine, subtle sense of appreciation for the intimate, unostentatious joy of life, or the quiet, flowing way we, in Norway, do things," unquote. And now we come to the final question. Is there anything of America you would like to take with you to Norway, to transplant in Norway? Some point out that many things, American, cannot readily be transplanted to Norway, but many would like to see American plumbing all over Norway, or a Norwegian version of the American idea, the drugstore, the cafeteria, the hot dog stand, the overnight cabins along the highways, the objectivity found in the best American newspapers and magazines. They would like to enjoy all the American technical advancements and the abundance of American food, vegetables, and fruits. But here, I think, is the most important side of this question, answered as follows.
What I hope to take with me home to Norway is a relatively objective and realistic knowledge of this country. Then, within my own field of activity, do all I can to further cooperation between Norway and America. Every country must transplant and utilize the experiences of other countries in harmony with its own historical and economic background. Let us hope that we, in our different fields, will become American experts, so that we, in due time, can make use of all that we have learned in America.
Another writes,
"What I shall bring with me home to Norway is a deep interest in the happiness and welfare of this country. Because I've learned to appreciate and to love all the best things I have seen over here. It is my hope that Americans will be in a position continually to add to this imposing structure. May they build on the real foundation of America, the spirit of the American Constitution, and I may add that the Constitution of Norway."
as set forth in 1814, was mainly built on the idea of the American Constitution of 1787, 25 years earlier in history. Finally, we have the statement of a man who served as representative in the Norwegian Congress, or Storting. Quote, "I am thankful for the years I've spent in America. The United States has a key position in our world today. Among the people of Norway and in the hearts of Norwegians, America has always had an imposing position compared with all other nations. This may or may not be deserved. During the war, home in Norway, people looked forward to the time when America would step in. They felt confident that when this happened, the Germans would lose, as they did last time. The United States did step in, and by its help, we are now winning the war. With the help of the United States, we can also win the peace." Unquote. These statements are the essence of the vast amount of material brought forth by a questionnaire in a Norwegian language newspaper in Brooklyn.
Thank you very much, Mr. Soyland, for a most interesting talk. And you've just heard another program in the series Norway Fights On, presented by the Royal Norwegian Information Service, an agency of the Royal Norwegian Government. So until our next visit with you, goodbye, everybody. Norwegian Information Service presents another transcribed program in the series Norway Fights On. At this time, we present the story of Spitsbergen. Don Cordray in London interviews for us three Norwegians who have been in Spitsbergen at various times during the last 3 years.
Our story today deals with Spitsbergen, which may or may not mean too much to our American listeners. Spitsbergen was recognized as a Norwegian possession by the Allied and Associated Powers in 1920, subsequently by Russia in 1924 and Germany in 1925. Sometime after the German occupation of Norway, a German administration was sent to Spitsbergen to take over the Norwegian coal mines. In 1941, in September of that year, an Allied expedition landed in Spitsbergen and destroyed the coal mines and all other installations, and then withdrew, taking with them the entire population. Shortly afterwards, a German garrison arrived in Spitsbergen and built an air base. Well, that's the beginning of our story. Now let's place Spitsbergen on the map. It's situated between 74 and 81 degrees north latitude. Well, that's about 500 miles nearer the North Pole than the northernmost point of Alaska. The distance from the north of Norway to South Cape on Spitsbergen is about 360 miles. Spitsbergen itself consists of a group of islands. There are two large ones, West Spitsbergen and Northeastland, and a number of smaller ones. Work in the coal mines on the island goes on all year round, as the west coast is warmed by the Gulf Stream. Export of coal has hitherto taken place only during the summer months, owing to the ice drift and the freezing over the fjords. The Norwegian mines are in the neighborhood of Longyear City on the ice fjord. Oh yes, incidentally, Longyear City is named after an American who first started mining on Spitsbergen about 1910. We have in the studios today three Norwegians who have been on Spitsbergen at various times during the past 3 years. One in 1942, the other in 1943, and finally, one in 1944. Now, here is Per. Well, we can't give you full names because Per, for example, still has relatives in Norway. He was there in 1942.
Yes, we sailed to Spitsbergen in the spring on board an icebreaker and a fishing vessel.
And just why did you go to Spitsbergen?
Well, primarily to carry on meteorological work. Well, as we approached Spitsbergen, we saw no signs of the Germans. The ice was too thick in the ice fjord, which leads up to Longyear City, for us to force a way through, so we went up a small branch fjord, the Green Fjord, to Barentsberg. Well, that's the Russian mining center.
What, you mean there are also Russians on Spitsbergen?
Yes. Well, actually, the Dutch started this mining village, but sold it to the Russians. We began to force the ice towards Barentsberg, but when we were only about a mile away, we were discovered by four German bombers. We were a sitting target stuck there in the middle of the ice, and it was not long before one of our ships had been sunk and the other set on fire.
And what did you do then?
Well, all we can do was to jump into the water and crawl onto the ice. The Germans continued machine gunning us, and we had to lie still on the ice pretending to be dead.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty cold, I can tell you, and we had to lie there for about an hour, wet through. Then, when the last of the planes had cleared off, we crawled across the ice onto the shore. We were in a pretty hopeless plight, stranded there in the Arctic. We hadn't been able to save much from the burning ship before she sank.
What were you able to save, though?
Well, we got a dozen rifles, some light ammunition, 15 pairs of skis, a couple of rucksacks, a pair of binoculars, and a map, and a compass.
And what about the food?
Well, we hadn't saved any from the ship, but we found some stores at Barentsberg. And one of the things lacking was meat. But we knew there had been some pigs on the island, so we found the pigsty and started to clear away the snow. And sure enough, there was the pigs, and frozen and still eatable.
Oh, that's excellent. But what about the Germans? Did they return at any time?
Well, their planes came back day after day, bombing and machine gunning. And our positions looked pretty hopeless. But one day, a British plane appeared and saw our signals, and that gave us fresh hope. Then in the middle of June, another plane came up and landed in the ice fjord. It brought us equipment and took back seven badly wounded men. We were told that more help would arrive soon, and sure enough, a month later, a British naval force arrived and landed a garrison of Norwegian troops, and above all, weapons and equipment.
And you were very thankful for that, I know. But were you still being bombed every day?
Well, until the end of May, they kept it up regularly. But after that, we didn't see very much of them.
Why was that?
Well, I was coming to that. Well, as the Germans have been using twin-engine bombers, we had suspected that they had a base on Spitsbergen itself, and probably somewhere near Longyear City, which was only 60 miles away.
I see.
We sent out a patrol and found a German airfield there. But as we had no weapons, we couldn't attack them. But we spent several nights circling round and round the encampment, making hundreds of ski tracks. The Germans were evidently much impressed. And believe it or not, from that time onwards, we didn't see very much of them.
That was a splendid idea, that circling round and round again. So what happened when the Norwegian reinforcements arrived, though?
Well, the Germans evacuated Longyear City altogether.
Well, now that's the story of Spitsbergen in 1942. Now here is a cameraman who was there in 1943, Gunnar Mella. How long were you in Spitsbergen, Mella?
I arrived in July, in the middle of the summer, and stayed for 4 months. I want to give you a different picture of Spitsbergen. You've heard about the ice and so on, but what struck me most was the scenic beauty of the country, so remote, cold, and peaceful.
Now, just what do you consider summer in Spitsbergen in the way of temperature, Mella?
Well, it may surprise you to know, after all you just heard of the grimness of the winter, that the summer sun can be extremely pleasant.
Now, let's not evade the issue. Just what do you mean by pleasant?
Well, with the midnight sun shining overhead night and day and sheltered by the mountains, the summer in some of the valleys can be as pleasant as an autumn day in Norway, about 70 degrees Fahrenheit.
Oh, that's splendid, about 70 degrees. Now, oh yes, what were your duties?
Apart from photography, I took part in the patrols which we sent out all over the island to ensure that there were no unwanted guests. German U-boats and reconnaissance planes paid frequent visits.
That I understand. Well, why was it that the Germans were so interested in Spitsbergen?
They had to make up for the loss of their meteorological stations, and one of their tasks was to make weather observations. We also suspected the Germans of pitting parties ashore to erect small meteorological stations. Spitsbergen Fjords, too, were good hideouts for the U-boats which preyed on the Arctic convoys to Russia.
But nothing really happened of any importance, did it?
Oh, yes, it certainly did. One night, a big German fleet was heading up the Eidsfjord.
What? An entire German fleet? What was the point of that?
That's what we were wondering. An entire battle fleet to attack a small garrison of 100 men seemed ridiculous to us.
It does to me, too.
Apparently, we hadn't realized how important we were to the Nazis. The German fleet comprised of two battleships, the Tirpitz and the Scharnhorst, incidentally, and seven or eight destroyers. Half the fleet attacked Longyear City and the other half Barnsburg.
Well, that was quite some fleet. The two battleships, the Tirpitz and the Scharnhorst, and seven or eight destroyers.
So what happened then? Well, I was at Barnsburg, but I don't think I have time to tell you about the engagement. There were many heroic incidents. Several destroyers were hit. By our fire, we fought on for several hours. The German landed three landing parties and tried to encircle us. But most of us managed to get away into the mountains. Actually, we were helped by a smoke screen, a curtain of black dust raised by German shells, which hit a coal dump. Still, they took many prisoners.
And did they destroy the meteorological station?
Yes, everything. And then they withdrew. We sent patrols over to the other Norwegian garrison in Longyear City. They had had the baddest time as we had. Everything destroyed. So there we were, stranded again and facing an Arctic winter without supplies or equipment.
But you left before winter came out, didn't you?
Yes. A relief party arrived about 6 weeks later.
And then what did you do in the meantime?
We lived on the fats of the land. That is, we shot reindeer, musk oxen, ptarmigan, and seals. What we lacked most was potatoes and cigarettes.
Thank you very, very much indeed, Gunnar. And in that relief party that Gunnar is talking about was the third Norwegian, who, like the first, cannot be named because of his relatives in Norway. We'll call him Tor.
As we approached Spitsbergen, I still hadn't the faintest idea of what we would find. As a matter of fact, I didn't expect to find anything or anybody.
And what did you find, Tor?
The first thing we saw as we approached Longyear City was that the coal dumps and the mine shafts were still burning. The whole town had been burned to the ground. Not a building was standing. Then the Norwegian survivors signaled to us. About half the garrison had survived. Just as we landed, a U-boat surfaced close inshore. We had some anxious moments while we raced to prepare for battle. The U-boat crew made ready to shell our equipment, lying unprotected on the shore. But we won the race. We got a machine gun erected, and when we started firing, the U-boat crash-dived.
Oh, that was splendid. I'm certainly glad that they did. Incidentally, how did you like living up there?
I liked it. We had some wonderful hunting. But we had to look out. Suddenly, a polar bear might come sliding down the glacier on its behind and be on top of us in no time.
Oh, that's splendid. You probably had quite some time for yourself.
I can tell you a story about a bear. Having been slightly injured by a fox trap, this bear got so mad that it went all along the whole trail, destroying hundreds of traps.
I know some radio producers like that. But go on.
Well, it had its grim aspects, too. One day, a man fell down the crevice in the ice. He got stuck 90 feet below the surface, so we tied together all the ropes and straps and cloths we had, but it wasn't long enough. So some of us rushed off to get some more rope, but he froze to death within a short time while we were still talking to him to try to keep him cheerful.
That was the glacier, I suppose.
Yes, the 90 feet high walls of the crevice were of solid ice.
Did you like it up there?
Most of us did, I think. Though some felt the strain of a long winter when it was dark day and night, and when the blizzard would blow for days on end.
Yes, I can imagine that, too. By the way, did most of you come from Spitsbergen?
Some of us did. They took the total destruction very much to heart. They had tears in their eyes when they saw the ruins of Barentsburg. That was a Russian town. It had been a model community with up-to-date laboratories. The Russians and the Norwegians had been great friends and used to hold great parties before the Germans came.
Thank you very much indeed, Tor. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was the story of Spitsbergen from 1940 until 1944. The story was told to us by three Norwegians who have been on the spot. Again, I want to thank all three of you very, very much indeed. Per, Tor, and Gunnar Mæle.
You have heard another program in the series Norway Fights On, presented by the Royal Norwegian Information Service, an agency of the Royal Norwegian Government. And so until our next visit with you, goodbye, everybody.